Okay.
Good morning. Let's open in word prayer. Our Heavenly Father, Lord, we do thank you for today, Lord. Thank you for the beautiful day you've given us, Lord's Day. Lord, we do pray, Lord, as we come today, Lord, we look forward to what you have for us today. The message you've given the pastor, Lord, we look forward to hearing that, Lord. And once again, we pray, Lord, that our hearts and minds are right with you. Lord, we thank you for each and everyone that's here today. And Lord, we just ask that we sing these songs of praise, Lord, and we lift our voices up. And we just ask that all the things we do today, we do asking for your will to be done, yeah, and looking towards you, mm-hmm, knowing that you are the author and finisher of our faith, Lord, knowing that it is everything we have is through you. So we thank you so much, Lord. We just ask once again to bless this time. We ask it in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Let's all stand, please. We want to turn to song number 20. Song number 20. How great thou art.
Thank you.
Of course, don't forget our Calvary Baptist Bible Institute. Well, of course, it's offered our Bible Doctrine 1 and an overview of the New Testament. And then a great day, for sure. Every once in a while, not every other Saturday or anything like that, but every once in a while, we do have a men's breakfast. Saturday, October the 17th at 10 in the morning. Menu, breakfast tacos. What is a breakfast taco?
You gave me the suggestion.
Was it my suggestion?
Yes, it was.
Do I need to come in and help create that?
No.
Okay.
Nope.
No, you don't want me to do that.
Nope.
Including but not limited to sausage, bacon, scrambled eggs, sauteed peppers and onions, cheese, fried potatoes. Ms. Shara asked me this morning, she said, well, which one of those things do you like? I said, I like them all. nothing in there. And raisin bramble. That sounds really good. So, men, you need to, encourage one another to come. It's a good time. It really is. We always have a good breakfast, have a good time of fellowship together. Also, birthdays, Jackie Murray, the 26th, and Ralph Hayton, the 30th. Be sure and keep them in your prayers and wish them a happy birthday. And that's all for the announcements. Praise the Lord. Amen. Blessed be the name. Amen.
Amen.
Yeah.
Amen.
Yeah.
And we will get fed up on the 17th.
Yeah,
we will be fed up.
So more so than other.
Men will be fed up. Sorry, ladies, but another time's coming. But
David.
I'm ready for that now.
Okay, let's all stand again. We're going to turn to song number 296. He leadeth me. 296.
Amen. comes to mind with that hymn. Lord is my good shepherd, amen.
Amen.
He leadeth me beside the still waters. Oh, it's wonderful to know sins are forgiven in Christ. I need for you to take the word of God. Dwayne, would you close that door, please? And I want you to find two places in your Bible. And I want you to find Judges chapter number 18, the book of Judges. That's in the Old Testament. Okay? It's in the big section of the Bible. The big part of the Bible. Okay? And then Romans chapter 13. It's the newt, the smaller part. But you'll know. Alright, so Romans chapter number. Judges chapter 18 and Romans chapter number 13. Just a great time at the rally on Monday night. Great, great time.
Yeah.
And like I said, that's the second time in his life that President Trump has seen me. There's no doubt. He even gave me the thumbs up. You know, I know it. I know it. It was so cool. It was great. And yeah. I told Paula, he looked right at me and he said, keep Calvary Baptist great, Michael. Nah, he didn't say that. He may have, but I don't
know.
It was a tremendous security presence that was there.
Yeah.
A tremendous security presence. And grateful to God for it.
Amen.
Grateful to God who serve in the capacity of law enforcement. I guess I have a special affection for that, having been in prison myself for 15 years. Some stoic looks right now, but I was a good guy. They let me home after 8 hours, okay? They let me home, well, you know the deal, but 15 years, but a great security presence was there. And, you know, you just felt really good because of it. Yeah. You felt really good because of it. There was, sheriffs were there, and TSA agents were there. The Secret Service was there. You know, I mean, they're not hard to spot, right? I mean, it could be midnight, and they're still wearing sunglasses, right? But they were there. I know that FBI agents were there. If you had seen on the news, there was actually two people that were apprehended and arrested somewhere along the train tracks in the Swanton area. They were coming from Virginia. They were coming from Virginia, a man and this woman. And they had backpacks, and in those backpacks, there was ammunition, and there were axes and weapons. And they were apprehended. They were apprehended. And so, you know, what would you want to be doing in Swanton? Well, I mean, I realize for, you know, the president's rally, but other than that, really, why would you come from Virginia to Swanton? Those of you who live in Swanton know what I mean, right? My brother Al, you know? So, but they were apprehended because of the security, because of the law enforcement. And so just so grateful to God for all of that. And there is a lot that's going on. Well, let me put it this way. There's some that's going on in this country that absolutely hate and despise our police and law enforcement officials and causing them great harm. You know that, and I watch this, and see, for fun, I watch C-SPAN. That's what I do for fun, okay? Since sports has taken a turn for the worst this year, you know, okay? I watch C-SPAN for fun. You know what C-SPAN is? Okay, some know, but it's nonstop news. It's just nonstop news. No, and you can call in and whatever, voice your concern or opinion. But oftentimes, they show the Senate when they're having a hearing or whatnot, or sometimes a congressional hearing. And there was a congressman, I think he was from Texas, and he had gotten up and he began to give his speech, and he held up a big block of cardboard, probably about 4x4 like this, with the number 43 on it. And that means that there have been so far this year alone, 43 police officers that have been killed in the line of duty. That's a 28% increase from all of last year. 43. And you know, you see that happening on the news. Police officers being shot, police officers being ambushed, sitting in their patrol vehicles. And it's a very serious matter, a very serious matter. Yesterday, down at the National Mall in Washington, D.C., Franklin Graham had led a day of national prayer. And you will not see this in the mainstream media, but there were tens of thousands of people who were there begging God to do something in this country. I'm grateful to God for something like that. I'm grateful to God for something like that. I'm going to preach a message today. It's a little bit different. I've entitled it, The Minister of God, in blue. We'll get to that when we turn to Romans chapter 13. The Minister of God, in blue. Now, I want to preface this by looking at this passage, this event that took place several thousand years ago here in Judges chapter number 18. You had the tribe of Dan, they had no inheritance at the time. And spies were sent, five of them were sent to spy out the land. And that was a common military strategic tactic that was often done in Israel, like what Joshua did. They went to spy out the land. And from where they were, they went northward about 100 miles into a place, a city called Laish. And they saw the city of Laish. Okay? So I want us just to begin reading here in verse number 1 to keep it into context here. So Judges 18, beginning in verse 1, we read, "In those days there was no king in Israel, and in those days the tribe of the Danites sought them an inheritance to dwell in, for unto that day all their inheritance had not fallen unto them among the tribes of Israel. And the children of Dan sent of their family five men from their coasts, men of valor, from Zorah and from Eshtaol, to spy out the land and to search it. And they said unto them, Go, search the land. And when they came to Mount Ephraim, to the house of Micah, they lodged there. When they were by the house of Micah, they knew the voice of the young man, the Levite, and they turned in hither. There and said unto him, Who brought thee hither, and what makest thou in this place, and what hast thou here? And he said unto them, Thus and thus dealeth Micah with me, and hath hired me, and I am his priest. And they said unto him, Ask counsel, we pray thee, of God, that we may know whether our way which we go shall be prosperous. And the priest said unto them, Go in peace. Before the Lord is your way, wherein ye go. Verse number 7. Then the five men departed and came to Laish, and saw the people that were therein, how they dwelt careless, after the manner of the Zidonians, quiet and secure, and there was no magistrate in the land that might put them to shame in anything. And they were far from the Zidonians and had no business with any man." So we'll pause right here. These five men came to this city of Laish. And when they came to the city of Laish, they saw a couple of things that were really quite astounding. Number one, there was no form of centralized government. There was no magistrate in the land to judge the people. There was no form of government that was there. And secondly, there was no security in the city to protect them. So when they came into this city, it made it very easy for them to conquer. Later on in the end of the chapter, you see that there. So they come to the city to spy it out, to see what it's about, and what they see is there's no government there. There's no government. There's no magistrate. And not only that, there's no security to protect them. You see, they did not have a treaty with the Zidonians who would provide them protection and security when they needed it. Nobody there to defend them when problems happened. Nobody to call in a time of need. Something must have happened. Something must have happened there in Laish, since they had no security there to protect them. Either they didn't want them, or maybe they just got tired of them, and a group of them just said, hey, let's forget about them, let's just defund them, and let's just take that money and put it elsewhere. You see where I'm going? Isn't that the cry today, defund? Is that not the most nonsensical thing there is?
Yeah.
Defund the police? I'll tell you what, you go into some of the communities in the cities where you know many are minority, and that's the last thing they want.
Right.
Because they know they need law enforcement to protect them. They know they need security. They were at ease here. When the Bible says here in verse number 7 that they were careless, quiet, secure, meaning at peace and ease, that's not a good thing because they had nobody to help them in a time of need. It's a very, very difficult situation here. And so this ultimately was an ideal place for the Danites to conquer, which they ultimately did. I believe for such a long time, going back here, the world has understood the necessity and the benefits of law enforcement. Our ministers in blue. You know, I'd said earlier that as of a week ago when I saw this on C-SPAN, but 43 of them have been killed in the line of duty this year. 43. One in Toledo back in the summer. Remember when that happened to that young man? 25 years old. He was murdered. Murdered. And like others who are in authority, because we're to be praying for kings and those who are in authority, that we might live a peaceable and quiet life, right? So that's what Paul told Timothy, and Paul told Timothy that when Nero was on the throne. We need to pray for our police officers.
Amen.
We need to pray for them.
Yeah.
They're people just like you and me. Make mistakes like you and me. Flesh and blood like you and me. They're not superheroes. Of course, some dishonor the badge that they wear. There's no question about that. But it's only a small amount.
Yes.
It's only a small amount. God has given us law enforcement. To protect us.
Yeah.
To protect us. And like I said, on Monday night, it was just great because there was so much protection around. Nobody was going to do anything. You know why? For he beareth not the sword in vain. I'm telling you, a cop does not carry a teddy bear on his side. You'll see what I mean here. Turn with me to Romans chapter 13. Romans chapter number 13, please. And my message is the minister of God in blue. Romans chapter 13, and we'll take a look at verses 1 through 4 here. All right, beginning in verse number 1. Remember what we just saw about Laish. There was no security to protect them, right? Verse 1 says this: let every soul be subject unto the higher powers. For there is no power but of God. The powers that be are ordained of God. Whosoever therefore resisteth the power, resisteth the ordinance of God, and they that resist shall receive to themselves damnation. For rulers are not a terror to good works, but to the evil. Wilt thou then not be afraid of the power? Do that which is good, and thou shalt have praise of the same, for he is the minister of God to thee for good. But if thou do that which is evil, be afraid, for he beareth not the sword in vain, for he is the minister of God, a revenger to execute wrath upon him that doeth evil. Three times in this section, you see the minister of God, you see the minister of God, and you see God's ministers. God's ministers. That's who those who are in authority are. Okay? They are God's ministers. Okay? And understand, first of all, and we'll look at this, they are, first of all, here, the representatives of God. Yeah. These ministers of God in blue are the representatives of God. Go back with me to verse number 1 and note what it says. Let every soul be what? Subject. That means to be in submission to. Let every soul be subject unto the higher powers. You see that? The higher powers. For there is no power but of God. The powers that be are ordained of God. Now the first thing is this. God is the source of all power.
Amen.
It all originates with him. Yeah. It begins with God. In fact, everything, it all begins with God. This is something that Daniel understood when he spoke to Nebuchadnezzar. There was a time when Nebuchadnezzar was in his kingdom, and his kingdom was flourishing, and it was Babylon, and it was great, and so forth. And Nebuchadnezzar thought that it was because of his doing that he had all of this power and authority. But Daniel said to him, "Till thou know that the Most High ruleth in the kingdom of men, and he giveth it to whomsoever he will." Why? Because God is the source of all power. And he speaks of the powers that are ordained of God. Now you think about what has God instituted. What has God instituted? Well, first of all, there's three great institutions of God. Number one, there's the family. The family. That's God's institution in Genesis chapter number 2. That institution is between a man and a woman. And by the way, that's the institution of marriage, and that is the only marriage that God recognizes.
Amen.
The institution between a man and a woman. God also gave the institution of the church. The church began with the Lord Jesus Christ. Upon this rock I will build my church. He prophesied, he predicted it. He went to the cross to bleed and die for the church, and the church began to function on the day of Pentecost. But that's of God's doing. He instituted it. He birthed it, and he's the one who's going to take it out of this world. There's the institution of the church, there's the institution of family, but yea, there is also the institution of human government. God gave government. He gave it. After the flood, we come to Genesis chapter 9 and verse number 6. And God had determined that Noah would be the magistrate of the land. And government was instituted in Genesis chapter 9 and verse number 6. And God said that if a man sheds another man's blood, his blood is also going to be shed by man. That was the institution of government. So what is all of that? Those are the powers of God. And God himself is the source of power. This is something the Apostle Paul was fully aware of. And he told Titus, he said this, "Put them in mind to be subject to principalities and powers, to obey magistrates, to be ready to every good work." The powers that be are ordained of God. Verse 2, he calls it the ordinance of God. Verse 4, the minister of God. Verse 6, God's ministers. Now, I want to say this to you. Okay? Almighty God himself is a God of law and order.
Yeah.
He is a God of, and that can be proven in the Bible. Note that God is a God of law. Hold your place here. But I want you to turn with me to Psalm number 89. Psalm number 89, please. And note that God is a God of law. Psalm number 89. And we'll take a look here at verses 30 through 32. Psalm number 89. In Psalm number 89, beginning in verse 30, Psalm 89, we see that God is a God of law. Psalm 89, beginning in verse 30, says this: if his children forsake my law, that's the law of God. If his children forsake my law and walk not in my judgments, right? Verse 31, if they break my statutes and keep not my commandments, watch what happens. Then will I visit their transgression with the rod and their iniquity with stripes. What does that tell us about the character of God? He's a God of law. He's a God of law. He is also a God of order. He is a God of order. 1 Corinthians 14 and verse 40 says, let all things be done decently and in order. So God has established government. He has given law, he has given commandments, he has given statutes. It's of his power. The powers that be are ordained of God. You know, in America, we have a constitutional republic. We elect our leaders. Thankfully, amen. We elect our leaders. And now more than ever, we have to be vigilant about such a thing. Because I don't know if the word hanky-panky is right, but there's some hanky-panky going on.
Amen.
Stuff that's not good, right? Stuff that's not good. I believe that there's many that are trying to usurp our God-given and our constitutionally given means of voting for our elected officials. I'm praying every day about November the 3rd. Praying every single day about it. Because our Constitution is at stake. It's not just one man or a political party. It's the philosophy that I believe that is closest to God. A philosophy that's pro-life. A philosophy that's pro-Israel. A philosophy that wants to set a Supreme Court judge who is on all of these, who's on the right side. You got to pray for this girl. You got to pray for her. Got to pray for Amy. Amy Coney Barrett, you got to pray for her. Because she is already being viciously attacked by a mob. She's a wonderful woman. I don't know her. I know she went to Notre Dame, so she's got to be good. Yeah, amen. Yeah. Okay, something good coming from Notre Dame, right, this year. I can't go see Notre Dame play Clemson, but I'm going to pray for Amy Coney Barrett. So we got to pray for her because they're already attacking this woman's faith and they're attacking her family. Her family. She's adopted two children from Haiti.
Wow.
And she's raised these children to be young people of faith and integrity and honor and to do what's right. And I like her because she's thus saith the Constitution. You see what I mean? See, God is a God of law and order. And when we elect our officials, they become public servants. And we expect them to carry out the law as it is written in the United States Constitution. Now, if they don't, then there's a problem. Because we have a conscience from God. We have a conscience from God, and it is better to obey God than man. Amen. All the time. So we see in these verses here the representatives of God. God's given us government, and we're grateful to God for the government that we have.
Yeah.
Now, I'm mindful of the fact that we have liberty, but I'm also mindful of the fact that some in government have been working hard to remove some of the liberties that we enjoy so much. And they're still working hard on churches in California to keep them closed and shut down. And I was talking with my brother the other day about this, and we're kind of going back and forth, but I just said, hey, listen, God is able. He is able to do exceeding abundantly above all that we ask or think. Right, so the ministers of God in blue are his representatives, the representatives of God. Now, note with me, turn back to Romans chapter 13 if you haven't done so. So we have the representatives of God in Romans 13, verse number 1. In verse number 2, we have the resistors of God. Those who resist God. Verse number 2. Now notice, please, in verse 2, whosoever. Boy, that's pretty broad, isn't it? Whether it's the politician or the preacher or the policeman. Whosoever what? Therefore resisteth the power, the powers that be are ordained of God, resisteth the ordinance of God, and they that resist shall receive to themselves damnation. Notice that word resist, to resist. The word resist means to set oneself against. It means to withstand. It means to oppose. You know, you see that almost nightly on the news when it comes to the police officers in some of the cities here in America. You got a group called Antifa.
Yeah.
Huh? You got a group called Antifa. And they're not just hurling insults at the police. They're fighting against them. They're resisting them. But yea, beyond all of that, they are resisting against Almighty God. They're fighting against him. And they that resist shall receive to themselves what? Damnation. Damnation. That's it. That's it. It's a fearful thing to fall into the hands of the living God, especially in such a situation like this. So these resistors of God, there's two things about this. Number one, there is a spiritual problem here, a spiritual problem. Resisteth the ordinance of God. They're resisting what God has ordered to be. You know, at the problem of every problem, there's a spiritual problem. At the problem of every single problem is a spiritual problem. Those who fight and resist in cities where you have these groups that are, you know, burning it down and doing all of this, there's a very serious spiritual problem there. Amen. You know, we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities. Against powers, yes. Against spiritual wickedness in high places.
Yeah. Yes.
That's where it's happening. You know what this is? This is the continuing long war against God. This whole thing, resisting and burning cities, there's nothing peaceful about that. You ever see some of the nonsense like on CNN? The Communist News Network?
Yeah.
You ever see some of that right there? You know, in one of these cities over the summer, they had one reporter out there, this has been a largely peaceful protest. Boom! The whole thing's blowing up behind them. You ever see that? A whole car lap goes up in flames, but it's been a largely peaceful protest. People dying in the streets, that's largely peaceful, right? That's largely peaceful. It's crazy. It's crazy. But they are resisting the ordinance of God. And I'm convinced that this whole scheme, this whole philosophy is energized by the devil himself. It's energized by Satan. I mean, killing people, destroying businesses, setting things to fire. There's a real, real problem. A real problem in America. Tearing down the ancient landmarks, the statues. But you know, the president has declared anybody who does that again is going to the Huskow. That means prison. And I'm thankful for that. I'm thankful for that. We learn from history. We're not to cancel it. We're not to cancel it. I'm glad they haven't canceled Halloween trick-or-treating this year. Yeah. I mean, they talked about it. But I mean, is that not the craziest thing? Well, you're going to cancel it, right? Kids can't go out, but wait a second, they're already covered head to toe in a mask. How's that going to be a problem? You know? I mean, what's next? Christmas? Because of jolly old Saint Nick? You know, who was that? Not Elmer Fudd. But man, who was the cartoon character? Double guns on his side.
Yosemite Sam.
Yeah, Yosemite Sam, amen. Glory to God for Yosemite Sam. Okay? Double pistols. But now they want to cancel him out. Because he's got two guns on his side. Is that not the most ridiculous thing I saw? Yes, amen. Yosemite Sam. We watched him growing up, right?
Yeah.
Sunday mornings were great. I never went to church. No, I was 10, 12 years old. We didn't go to church. I mean, I didn't get saved to ask Lexi when I got saved. She knows. But I mean, every Sunday morning at 10 o'clock, it would be the Bugs Bunny Roadrunner hour. Remember them? And then at 10:30 it would be Yosemite Sam. And at 11 o'clock, my favorite time of the week, because it would be 2 hours nonstop of Abbott and Costello. that was just the best time, you know? And you'd stay, you know, and maybe some still do, stay in their pajamas all day long, and I mean, you just had a great time. But you know what I mean, though? There's the idiocy to cancel all this stuff. Which is good. It's good stuff, right? It's good stuff. The resistors of God have a spiritual problem. And it is something that Stephen said to the Pharisees when he is preaching the resurrection of Christ in Acts chapter 7 and verse number 51. He said, "Ye stiff-necked and uncircumcised in heart and ears. Ye do always resist the Holy Ghost. As your fathers did, so do ye." He said, you're uncircumcised in heart and ears. You know what that means? They were lost.
Right.
You know, it means that they had not the Spirit of God. You know, the problem with the Pharisees and the Jewish leaders of the day is that they rejected both the Son of God, and then by murdering Stephen, they rejected the Spirit of God. Yes. So God's great salvation then went to the Gentiles. But what I'm saying is this, the resistors of God, they have a spiritual problem. They have a spiritual problem. There's also here a severe punishment. Because in verse number 2 it says, "And they that resist shall receive to themselves damnation." Damnation. A severe punishment awaits. So you see the resistors of God. And so divine judgment comes to those who disobey. Now we come to verse number 4, which is really the whole text of what I wanted us to see today. And there we have the revengers of God. So we've seen God's representatives, we've seen the resistors, and now we see the revengers of God in verse number 4. Well, let's read verse 3 to keep it in context. We read, "For rulers are not a terror to good works, but to evil. Wilt thou then not be afraid of the power? Do that which is good. Do that which is good, and thou shalt have praise of the same. For he is the minister of God to thee for good. But if thou do that which is evil, be afraid. For he beareth not the sword in vain. For he is the minister of God, a revenger to execute wrath upon him that doeth evil." You notice the fear? Right here in verse number 3, rulers are not a terror to good works, but to the evil. Wilt thou then not be afraid of the power? Proverbs 29 verse 2 says, "When the righteous are in authority, the people rejoice." when the righteous are in authority, both politicians and police, when they're doing right, it's good.
Yeah.
It's good. And we need to be people of prayer who are praying for our elected officials. That they would continue, that they would do good, that they would do right, that they would pass laws that would be a help to us. It's amazing what you have. I mean, you know, the choice that we have coming, the contrast couldn't be any greater, as far as I'm concerned. The contrast could not be any greater. And so God gives us rulers, and he gives us those in authority. And by the same way, by the same token, when those who are in authority, be it the politician or the cop, okay, that's just as wrong as right is right. When they do things that are wrong, when they do that which is wrong, and it goes against, for example, the Constitution. You know, churches have been hit hard over these past 6 months.
Yes.
They've been hit very, very hard. And I will say this, when elected officials shut down churches but keep liquor stores open, that's wrong. That's wrong. When rulers mail cease and desist letters to churches but allow the riots to continue, that's wrong. That's wrong. I just saw the other day, maybe you saw it also, but there was an outdoor worship service somewhere, okay? And three people who were there were arrested. Three worshipers were arrested at this service. So, in other words, the officials and who told, you know, the police, boom, get them and them, right? They were arrested. And it was because, hey, they're not keeping the 6-foot guideline or wearing a mask. But the ones who were arresting them were not wearing a mask also. You see what I mean? And I go back to this long war against God. And I'm going to go home this afternoon and I'm going to flip on John MacArthur and I'm going to see what he's going to have to say about it today. Because the government there, where he is working so hard to shut him down. They have rented the parking lot for the last 45 years where people park. They've rented it from the city or whatnot, but now they've taken that parking lot space away from them. There's several independent Baptist churches along the left coast. North Valley Baptist Church, where Jack Treber is the pastor out there. And we met him down when we were in Tennessee. He's been fined $5,000 a day. $5,000 a day. But he refuses to shut down. Amen.
Amen.
He refuses to shut down. I'm telling you this, with all that I see in the Word of God, Judgment Day is coming. The day of judgment is coming. Now, I know the rapture happens first. Amen. And I certainly would not want to be left behind after that happens here. But the Lord Jesus Christ, who is eternal God, who sees all things and knows all things, is coming again in power and great glory. And he's coming right back to the Mount of Olives. The very place where he ascended to heaven from, he's coming right back again. And bless God, he's going to rule and reign on earth for 1,000 years. That's not symbolic, that is literal. That's a literal millennial kingdom. That's when, we pray, thy kingdom come. Bless God, thy kingdom come. May it even be so, Lord. And when Jesus Christ rules and reigns on planet Earth, there's not going to be any rioting. There's not going to be any law enforcement officials being murdered.
Right.
If so, Instant justice. Mm-hmm. Perfect justice is meted out. Because the Father has committed to the Son all judgment. The Lord Jesus Christ is the supreme judge in all of this. And this whole business that's been going on for so long has just been energized by Satan. And I believe ultimately to get to the church. To get to the church. Because it's something that God had said way back yonder in Genesis 3:15. The seed of the woman and that of the serpent. You know, the devil tried everything to keep Jesus Christ from being born. He even tried to keep him from going to the cross. Tried to keep him from going to the cross. For he knew he was a defeated foe. He knew he was. God is almighty and he's all powerful. He rules in the kingdoms. He is sovereign over all. As Christians, we thank God that we live in America. And we can cast a vote.
Yes.
And pray. Because in reality, what do we want to do? We just want to live a peaceable life.
Sure.
Huh? We want to live a peaceable life. Own a plot of land. Raise children to the glory of God. Right? Leave something there for them. So that they can do the same. Right? That's pretty much what it comes down to. I mean, I don't know if anybody wants to be a millionaire or if you have $1 million to spare, but if you do, see me in about 10 minutes. But the fact of the matter is, ultimately, this world is not our home. Our citizenship is heaven, from whence also we look for the Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ. So, let me just kind of bring it into context here. The minister of God in blue. What does God say about defunding the police? Does God say anything about it? Well, let's look at verses 5-7 and we'll be finished here. Just never believe a preacher when he says that. Never believe him when he says that. In conclusion. Because there's usually several points to the in conclusion. Verse 5, what does God say about the funding of police, government, and so forth? Wherefore, ye must needs be subject. The powers that be are ordained of God. We're to be in subjection to them, not only for wrath, but also for conscience' sake. For this cause pay ye tribute also, for they are God's ministers, attending continually upon this very thing. Render therefore to all their dues, tribute to whom tribute is due, custom to whom custom is due, fear to whom fear, honor to whom honor. We're to honor them who are there to protect and serve us. We're to honor them. Okay? No person is perfect. No one is. But God has put them there to protect us, to protect you and me, to live a life that's quiet and peaceable in the sight of God, in the sight of God. 1 Timothy, now we're in conclusion, but in 1 Timothy, I'll just read these verses. 1 Timothy chapter 2, verse 1. Paul said to Timothy, I exhort therefore that first of all, the very first thing, supplications, prayers, intercessions, and giving of thanks be made for all men, for kings, and for all that are in authority, that we may lead a quiet and peaceable life in all godliness and honesty. For this is the will, for this is good and acceptable in the sight of God, who will have all men to be saved and to come unto the knowledge of the truth. Why do we pray? Why do we pray for those in authority? Because we want them to be saved.
Amen.
because we want them to be saved, that they may come to the truth, that they may come to the Lord Jesus Christ, that they might be wonderfully saved. We thank God for the ministers in blue, the security that we have. I mean, on my phone right now, I've got it set to speed dial for the local PD. I just have to bang, and I know them. And I know them. They've been here. They've been a help to me here. They have on certain occasions, and they'll come and they'll be right here. They'll be right here. How many of us knows someone who is in law enforcement? Yeah. Look at that. Just about everybody. Yeah, just about everybody. Okay. We need to pray for them. We need to pray for them. We're going to sing a song of invitation. You would come. If you'd like to come today and pray for that particular police officer that you know, that law enforcement official that you know, someone like that, by all means, come. Come and pray today. Let's all stand to our feet and let's turn to
song number four.
Song number four.
Which is Great is Thy Faithfulness.
Great is Thy Faithfulness.
Number four. Thank you for them, Lord. Mm-hmm. We do know that They're put there by you. Lord, our prayer is that each and every one of them knows you. Lord, but we do, once again, just ask you just to protect them in a mighty, mighty way. Lord, during these times we have right now in our country, if ever there was a time, Lord, just to, once again, just envelop them with your safety, Lord. We just pray so much for that right now. And Lord, we do pray for the politicians that you have put into place. Lord, even in cases where we may not agree necessarily, Lord, we do know that if it's a person that's following your will, Lord, or following what you should be doing, or what you want them to do, Lord, that once again, we just pray for them, Lord. We pray that that once again, because they represent you, because they're put there by you,
yes,
Lord, just to be with them in a mighty, mighty way, Lord.
Yes.
We pray for our country, Lord, that our country makes the right decisions,
yes,
Lord, and that once again, we can be continue to be free, Lord, continue to be a nation under God, Lord, following you. Lord, once again, we thank you so much for each and every one of them. Lord, we thank you for each and every one that's here today. Lord, we thank you for the spirit that's here today. The great singing we had, Lord, the great message you've given us today that you put on the pastor's heart, that, Lord, a message is so relevant, Lord, and so true, Lord. Thank you for that, Lord. We pray as we go about the day today, Lord, we keep this in mind.
Yes,
don't forget it as we walk out those doors throughout this week. Thank a police officer,
yeah,
Lord, if we have the opportunity, Lord.
Sure.
If we know any personally, Lord, that we pray for that person specifically. And Lord, once again, we know that we know our prayers will be answered by you. Lord, thank you for today. Be with us throughout the rest of the day. Give us someone to tell about you. And Lord, we pray, Lord, that once again, that your will be done in that case, Lord. That no person would go to that eternal hell, Lord. That,
right.
They don't need to go. Lord, we just pray for that. So, Lord, once again, bless the rest of today and bless today. Lord, we bless this offering today, too, that we're giving today. Thank you so much for giving us the opportunity to give today. Lord, thank you for the missionaries that we support, Lord. We thank you for each and every one. Their deep heart they have for you, how they're out literally all over the world right now. You know, telling others about you, leading others to you, Lord. And we thank you, each and every one of them. Bless this offering in a mighty way. Once again, Lord, we ask just be with us throughout this week. We ask all this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Amen.